All right, everybody, with us today is John Jacobus from Lone Juniper Capital. John is the Managing Director of Lone Juniper Capital Management and investment firm specializing in operating manufactured housing communities in the Southeast and Southwest. The firm targets properties requiring significant operational improvement and expansion opportunity. His investment philosophy is rooted in the principles of value investing. He is considered, he considers Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger as foundational figures in shaping his investment approach. John, thanks for being with us today. I know we've met up actually in Manhattan, had lunch together there for a meetup. And you told us about some of the stuff you had going on at that time, and interested to hear how you have progressed along the way, because I know you had some in the pipeline, you were and looking for some more. So I'll let you take it away and tell everybody what you have going on.
Sounds great. Yeah, thanks, Brandon. Thrilled to be here. You guys put on a great conference. I've been enjoying all the content so far this weekend. So what better way than to spend a couple of hours over a couple of days talking about real estate and for this, you know, a couple of hours talking about manufactured housing communities. So you guys did a great intro on me, Brandon. I just got started in manufacturing housing communities about a year ago. I started looking 2 years ago and then finally ramped up on our acquisition activity here within the past year. Really just want to give listeners a chance to learn some of the basics about this unique niche, give a sense for sort of the nuances of the industry, why it's attractive, lend some insight into how we go about finding them, operating them, performing due diligence on them, and then walk through some case studies. So that's really the objective for this presentation today. And of course, would like to take some questions from the audience and help people learn about this really appealing, attractive investment niche within real estate. So I talked a bit about the agenda. So I'll tell you about me, how I got started in real estate. Got started rather young and transitioned, took a couple of different paths, transitioned ultimately into manufactured housing communities. Want to talk a little bit about why. I know it's a weird niche. It is emerging in popularity now, given some of the headline news that is making its way through the various media channels and through various groups and appearances at these popular conferences. I want to talk through the aspects of why there is some interest in this interesting niche. We'll talk about the different types of communities. There isn't just one type of mobile home park or manufactured housing community. There's all sorts of variations on them, and we'll talk a little bit about what makes them different in different parts of the country based on who owns them and where they might be located and the type of residents that occupy them. Talk about how to define them, how to evaluate them, how to operate them. And then I've got two interesting case studies where I can walk folks through how we found our first two parks, some interesting aspects of those deals, some of the challenges that we faced while trying to acquire them, and what we have experienced so far in operating those parks. So first, a little bit about me. Brandon did a great job with the background. I am a principal at Upward Communities. We are a firm that's focused on acquiring value-add manufactured housing communities, and we focus specifically in the Southeast and the Southwest. We like that region of the country primarily because of the demographic movement. We see a lot of population and job growth there, and there's also that combined with a large number of inventory, large amount of inventory of manufactured housing communities available to reposition and add value to. We like the idea of solving the affordability housing crisis that exists in this country, and while doing so, creating a safe and affordable place for our residents to live. One of the unfortunate things about manufactured housing communities in certain parts of the country is that they haven't been well maintained, and the residents suffer as a result. So we like to be part of that solution and upgrading the utilities, just generally enhancing the overall nature of the community so that people can still maintain an affordable place to live while also benefiting from just the aesthetically pleasing things that majority of the rest of the citizenship experience in apartment communities or single family homes. So as I mentioned earlier, I got started really young I was about 20 years old when I started fixing and flipping single family homes in Southern California with my dad. My dad took an opportunity to teach my brother and I about wealth creation by taking advantage of a housing cycle in Southern California in the early part of this century. So I didn't have any income, didn't really have any money other than the meager savings that I assembled over, you know, years of growing up and mowing lawns and doing chores. But I put that capital to use and learned a pretty valuable lesson by identifying value creation opportunities, executing a business plan, and then ultimately liquidating and rolling it into another project and another and another. So over the course of a couple of years, my brother and I really got hands-on experience in how to use real estate as a pretty powerful wealth creation vehicle. That got me, you know, certainly got bit by the real estate bug there, but also just got interested pretty intensely in compounding wealth and investing in general. And that set me down a couple of different paths, including learning about businesses and publicly traded companies and ways in which I could compound my wealth, not only through owning value-add real estate and executing projects to unlock value, but also understanding what good looks like in businesses. So, and I've continued to do that throughout my professional life. I went to school in Arizona at the University of Arizona. Shortly after graduation, I moved back to the San Francisco Bay Area, which is where I'm from. And I joined a large global management consulting firm, which is Accenture. And I spent the first 11 years of my career there helping large global organizations transform their back office operations. At the time, I had no aspirations to be involved in real estate other than it being a side hustle and a way for me to take income and savings and compound it by doing things on the side. And I didn't really see a parallel at the time, but now that I have had that experience at Accenture and working with companies to sort of unlock value in their operations and apply systems and consistent processes and infrastructure to help things operate more effectively, I'm now really seeing a direct parallel and able to bring some of those learnings and experiences from my professional life at Accenture to running a manufactured housing community. I call myself a value investor as a technical term. You may not be able to see here easily, but I've got Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger, you know, close to my heart here on the shirt. Value investing is a school of thought that began out here in Manhattan at Columbia Business School. A fellow by the name of Benjamin Graham started a school of thought around investing around three core concepts. The concept of the margin of safety. So the sense that you can't quite master everything, and in investing, in order to, you know, employ conservatism and position yourself for success in a way that recognizes that you can't always have everything figured out and all nuances covered and calculated, operating with a margin of safety, i.e. make sure you get a sufficient discount when you buy an asset such that things can go wrong and you can still make out and exit an investment and still be okay. The second being this concept of Mr. Market, the fact that participants in the markets in which you're buying and selling assets act emotionally. So this concept of Mr. Market was every day Mr. Market knocks on your door and offers you either a wildly high price, a wildly low price, or just a so-so price. All of those factors based upon his personal state at the time. So whether he's upset or scared or anxious or exuberant, those would significantly drive what he would bid and offer you for whatever you're selling for the day. So just recognizing that market participants are emotional, and an astute investor can take advantage of those swings and those emotional behaviors in the market to their advantage, i.e. buy things cheap when people are downtrodden and sell to an exuberant market when people are very, you know, enthusiastic about buying things. And then the last concept, just being a business owner versus a speculator. So this concept of buying an asset as if it was the only business that you owned, and it's representative of cash flows and operating margins and actual assets that produce income, rather than simply a squiggly line on a chart or something that, you know, you may hold with the hopes that things would go up in value. So those are the three core concepts that really root my investment philosophy. As Brandon mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, you know, I am value investor. Warren Buffett, Charlie Munger have been foundational figures in the shaping of my investment approach. And I think those core reasons and some of the behaviors that those Warren and Charlie demonstrate led me to investing and focusing on manufactured housing communities. And I'll share a little bit more about that later. So I am recently focusing on manufactured housing communities. You know, I got started a couple of years ago in single family, pivoted and focused primarily on public equity investments, and then re-entered active investments in real estate through multifamily. As I think several, you know, we have several people on the lineup for this weekend's conference that are focused on multifamily investments. I love investing in multifamily. They are a core part of my portfolio, and still seek out investments in that asset class, but it's very competitive right now. And where I'm located in New York City, it's extremely difficult to compete with some local operators in markets that I invest in, which are hundreds, if not thousands of miles away from where I am currently residing. So in seeing that it was competitive and seeking other better valued opportunities, I pivoted 2 years ago in 2017 and started looking into manufactured housing communities. Recently formed Upward Communities with four other partners who are scattered across the country. We're all in trying to scale the business, and we've now got a portfolio of three mobile home parks and are looking to continue to scale, focusing on value-add parks and heavy turnarounds in the Southeast and Southwest. I'll pause here because I think there's some questions that are coming up. Yeah, so there's some issues with the connection. Let me just pause here a minute and make sure that we're
able to... Hey, John, sorry to interrupt. Yeah, I'm right here. Just the sound keeps cutting out. Sometimes if you stop your video, but leave your share up, we can still see and still hear you. It helps the video feed. It helps the feed because I'm trying to stream video.
Okay.
And help the sound out.
Brandon, is that, I cut the video. Just want to make sure that that actually did cut. It shows this cut on my side. So hopefully this improves things.
Yep, I've got you cut off.
Okay, sure. Great. All right, great. So that's a bit about me. So why invest in manufactured housing communities? You will hear me say MH, MHC, mobile home parks, MHPs. Apologies in advance, but it's also indicative of some of the unstructured nature of this crazy industry. So just know that they're all synonyms. We're all talking about the same thing. I think mobile home parks rolls off my tongue a little bit easier than manufactured housing communities. So bear with me as we get through the terminology. So, you know, I think you'll hear from me this afternoon a couple of things that on the surface seem negative and, you know, difficult, negative, unloved, negative stigma, a lot of sort of black marks on the industry. While on the surface level seems like an inherent bad thing, actually to dig into it is a good thing. So, you know, maybe it's just being weird. Maybe it's because I'm a value investor and I look for value. But, you know, one of the sexy things to me about mobile home parks is that they're so weird and strange. So I know that they don't make the headlines, and oftentimes people don't want to touch them with a 10-foot pole because of the, you know, what they've seen on TV or in the news. But the inherent characteristics of manufactured housing are actually quite appealing from an owner standpoint and even from a resident standpoint. So here I gave you with the visual, investing is sexy. This is me, age 16, and that's Warren Buffett to my right. While other people may not think investing in mobile home parks is sexy, I certainly do. And I hope I motivate some people and inspire people to think otherwise as well this afternoon. So one of the reasons why I really like this niche is it's demonstrated really stable performance throughout cycles. So in the up and the down cycles, we experience very steady demand and steady operations financially within manufactured housing. I've provided a visual here that shows the default rates or the delinquency rates for commercial mortgage-backed security debt on manufactured housing and a variety of other commercial real estate assets. You can see here this spans from 2000 all the way to 2018. And during that period of time, we've experienced two up cycles. So, you know, in the early 2000s through 2006, an extreme down cycle from 2007 all the way until 2013. And now we're sort of in the peak or close to a very extended upward trend in commercial real estate. You can see here, this line, this green line here, represents the default rate for manufactured housing communities. So this is debt placed on communities that are operated as investment property. You can see that at its peak, which was at 2012, the default rate on this debt was about 5.5%. And while it may not, you know, that may not mean anything for you, look at it relative to the other options. You can see that the only other commercial real estate asset type that had a lower default rate was self-storage. So you can see here, you know, other familiar players being multifamily, as the yellow line is here at about, you know, 9%, and at its peak it was 12%. So you've got substantial margin between the default rate of manufactured housing and its closest sister being multifamily and apartments at substantially higher rates. So this is an asset class and a specific niche that performs quite well in up and down cycles. And that's something that I really like about it. To further support that point, I've got a graphic here of the largest operator in the industry, which is Equity Lifestyle Properties. So Equity Lifestyle is owned by Sam Zell. Some may be familiar with him. He is credited with transforming the commercial real estate industry as a whole, and arguably the grandfather of the real estate investment trust. Now, this is representative of just ELS, so it is. I don't claim for this to be indicative of the entire industry itself, but they are the large operator, and they do have the data available and is published to the street because they're a publicly traded real estate investment trust. You can see here that Equity Lifestyles has, from 1998 through to 2012, also throughout a period where we experienced a pretty significant downturn in the economic cycle, you can see the NOI basically remained in a steady upward trend throughout that period of time. So, both just another indication of NOI being the driver of value in the asset class, another indicator of strong performance despite the economic cycle. That really appeals to me. Several other factors that make the asset class really attractive: it's experiencing quite limit constraints on its supply. So there are only about 40,000 manufactured housing communities throughout the US. And there has been almost no growth in the supply. So no new construction of mobile home parks throughout an extended period of time. The reason for that is there's an aversion amongst municipalities to expand the zoning for mobile homes. There's a variety of different reasons, some of which rhyme with, you know, the negative stigma. So cities just don't like to have mobile home parks in their communities. It drags down the value of surrounding single family homes. In some cases, it can attract tenants that are undesirable, unappealing, attract folks that, you know, city officials don't want in the area. In some cases, could drive increased crime. This isn't always true, and in fact, is rarely the case. But it's the stigma and it's the headline news. And when voters, you know, indicate that they have a distaste for a certain type of community, they make sure their elected officials know about it, and those officials take actions to appease their voting base. So zoning and just the aversion that the municipalities have to increasing the zoning for this property class is one of the ways in which the supply is constrained. The other is from a taxation standpoint, the property tax that's levied on manufactured housing owners is really a fraction of single family property taxes. And as a result, economically for the city, if you have a family of four that is only paying a couple hundred dollars in property tax, they're still utilizing the same services for fire, for schooling, for healthcare that a similar size family living in a single family home would, but they're not taking in as much income. So from an economic standpoint, it hurts the city to keep land that could be otherwise zoned as retail, office, or single family and generate a significantly higher tax base. So those are some of the factors that limit the supply. So that's a good thing if you're a community owner, because then you don't have to fear the pipeline of supply that may come online and impact pricing. So unlike office, retail, self-storage, and multifamily, that you know, owners do have to worry about incoming supply. With manufactured housing, that's a static, if not declining, variable, and it's a beneficial thing for owners. We talked a little bit about the stability of demand. So throughout economic cycles, the demand for manufactured housing has been stable. I'd argue that it's increasing, and we will, if not, we're already there, we'll continue to see the increase for affordable housing. We've got a wave of retirees that are very ill-equipped to face the realities of this new, you know, phase of their economic life, and I think that that will drive an extreme demand for affordable housing, and MH is one way to solve it. Next reason, negative public stigma, we talked a little bit about in the inefficient market. So the fact that these are unloved, you know, people sort of scrunch their nose and wrinkle their forehead when they hear about the concept, they see headline news that that casts it in a negative light, that affects pricing. So that makes it unattractive and unappealing. It works, you know, in the opposite direction of hype. So it's not Bitcoin, it's not Facebook, it's not Google, right? These are things that people don't want to associate with. While I brag about owning mobile home parks at cocktail parties, I'm one of very few people that I know that do that, and it affects pricing. So in a good way, meaning when you don't have to compete with a stampede of prospective buyers to buy a property, that benefits you as a buyer because you can get a more attractive price. This is also seen in the cap rates for manufactured housing properties relative to the other major commercial real estate asset classes. The cap rates for MH have been traditionally higher on average. That is coming down. There has been, we've experienced some recent popularity and continued popularity within manufactured housing because of the attractive economics of the business. It still remains competitive relative to the alternatives. The other factor in, I think it's just a function of the history and how the industry has grown up, it's rather inefficient. So we don't benefit from the price transparency that exists in some of the other classes of commercial real estate. So we can't oftentimes go to LoopNet or CoStar or other information sources and immediately have insight into comparables and get a good sense of pricing. And as a result, it means that, you know, price discovery is difficult in this market. So you can have a great opportunity to identify value and get a good deal relative to your ability to do so in some of the other alternative asset classes. This is a highly fragmented industry. And while there are a couple of big players who continue to expand their footprint within the industry, this is still an industry that is a majority owned by, call them mom and pop operators that own, you know, one or two communities and have done so for dozens of years, if not, you know, decades. So what that means for prospective investors is this is very fragmented. There aren't many standards. It's very haphazardly organized. That translates into deals and value and opportunity. So we have purchased all three of our parks from mom and pops, and they have owned their parks for between 20 and 30 years. And as a result, they own them free and clear. They don't have an obligation to a fiduciary obligation to maximize, you know, the exit price for outside shareholders. Many times they just want to get rid of a nuisance and they're tired and they've sort of had their fill of owning and operating a park. So this is very much the composition of the industry. And that's a very attractive thing for prospective investors because it means that there's value there and there's an opportunity to professionalize and augment the capability and raise up the liquidity of the asset class, which means greater returns for investors. The operating margins in this industry are quite high relative to some of the alternatives like multifamily. One of the main reasons for this is that if pursuing a tenant-owned community, many times you just own the land and the infrastructure. So that means that you don't have to deal with repairs on homes and repairs on some of the items that frequently break and require a lot of management and maintenance. So when you're just the dirt owner and you own the streets, the dirt, the lights, and the plumbing, that means you incur fewer expenses than you would if you own the actual housing structure. So we like the cash flow dynamics. We like the operating margins associated with this asset class. It's a good thing when operating margins are high. And then the last key thing that I think make investments in mobile home parks attractive is you've got other legends to look to who in a big way play a role in the industry and also find it attractive. So if for no other reason that's stated here, take a clue from two investment legends being Warren Buffett and Sam Zell. They're in the industry in a big way and they love this class of real estate. Warren Buffett owns Clayton Homes, which is the largest manufacturer of mobile homes in the country, also the largest financer of mobile homes in the country. And Sam Zell, as I mentioned before, he's the owner and founder of Equity Lifestyles, which is the largest real estate investment trust that owns and operates mobile home communities. So they have, both of the two have amassed a very large fortune, partially due to their long-term ownership and involvement in the industry. So if it's good enough for Warren, Sam, you know, you got a question, probably something worthwhile. So, you know, as I mentioned before, I transitioned from multifamily. The more discouraged I got about inability to compete, you know, difficulty in finding good deals, really thin margins, and really, you know, limited opportunity to generate outsized returns, the more I got to know manufactured housing and the more I dug into it, these are some of the things that emerged and really opened my eyes and got me excited about making investments in this area. So the types of communities, we don't benefit from a standard classification system that exists in the other major classes of commercial real estate. So office, retail, multifamily, and even self-storage benefit from a standard definition of what classes are. So class A, class B, class C. I know there's some gray areas around the margin, but generally speaking, there's a common language that financing companies, that brokers, that owners use to describe the asset. We don't benefit from that classification. So there's all sorts of variations in types of manufactured housing communities. And I use types in air quotes because, you know, it varies in different ways. So I want to spend some time and just talk about the nuances of manufactured housing communities and ways in which they may differ, which may drive pricing, which may drive your ability to operate them effectively and your ability to find them and or produce attractive returns by owning them. So talked a little bit about class A, class B, class C, class D being common in the industry. We don't use that classification system within manufactured housing. The closest thing that we have to it, although it fails, is a star system. So stars, I think, was an attempt to standardize classification in the 90s. It is not widely used, and it's rarely well understood and definitely not understood in a consistent way. But you will hear it if you decide to become more active in this area. So worthwhile describing it. So 4 to 5 stars being the pristine communities, many times Equity Lifestyles, you know, focuses on these 4 and 5 star parks. Many of the institutional owners will focus on owning these parks. They're typically located in the retirement areas of the country. So lots of 4 and 5 star parks in Florida, California, Arizona, Nevada, the Pacific Northwest, and even in the vacation spots within the Northeast. So these, you probably wouldn't know any better driving through the neighborhood that it was manufactured housing because it looks awfully similar to a single family subdivision. So you've got paved streets. In some cases, you've got curbs on the sidewalk. You've got light posts. Very clean, well-maintained, well-kept, and the tenant base resembles what you would find in a single-family housing community. So those are the 4 and 5 star parks. As you, you know, get a little bit more rougher around the edges, maybe you don't have curbs, maybe the streets are not as well-maintained, starting to wear away and crack and weeds grow through them, that's when you trend towards the fewer number of stars, so 4 stars. Roll that back about 2 to 3 levels and you get to the 2 to 3 star parks. This is actually where I and my partners through Upward Communities focus. These are rougher neighborhoods. It's a rough equivalent to class C properties. So a little bit older, probably, you know, built between the 50s and the 80s. It's not so nice to look at, whether that means it's got the residents keep trash in the yards, you know, inoperable vehicles, used tires, toys and children's, you know, playthings sprawled throughout the neighborhood. Typically there will be some vacancy associated with 2 and 3 star parks, either vacant lots or vacant homes. And then the 1 star parks is equivalent to your class D assets. So this is either a war zone or a completely empty park or something that just looks like an atrocity is, you know, what we would call a 1-star park. So definitely a lot of art there and little science. Again, it's useful terminology to know because you will encounter some brokers or banks talk about parks using the star system. It isn't very effective and not widely used, but worth knowing that it's out there. Second type of park is age-restricted parks. So while age is a protected class as it relates to fair housing, there are communities where they could be restricted based on the percentage of people that are above a certain age. So in manufactured housing, you have age-restricted communities, which are the 55-plus communities, and then you have family parks. So typically the 55 plus communities are focused on retirement areas of the country. So again, the Florida, California, Arizona, Nevada, the Sun Belt, typically nicer and well located, well maintained. And then the family parks don't have those same age restrictions. So you'll come across those that terminology and those types of parks as you go through and get to know a little bit more about the industry. A third way in which they differ and a variable that could be used to determine type is communities that have park-owned homes versus tenant-owned homes. So park-owned home refers to the fact that the community or the mobile home park actually owns the housing structure. So I was commenting before about the operating margins associated with parks that had primarily tenant-owned homes. And one of the benefits of that being that you didn't have to deal with the repairs on the housing structure, and as a result, could have fewer, lower operating expenses. There are communities that do have either all, a high percentage of, or some park-owned homes. In our experience, you know, it's just sort of the nature of the industry that over time, people will move out and leave their home behind, and you inherit park-owned homes. So we find that in the Southeast, there are a number of parks that have a high percentage of park-owned homes. Don't know why that is. It may be because the resident base on balance there can't afford to buy their own homes. Some regions throughout that area of the country aren't as economically robust, and as a result, people aren't able to own their own homes. So, but we find that there are a number of communities throughout the Southeast and other parts of the Deep South where they are either half or more than half park-owned homes. And then the flip is tenant-owned homes. So those are communities where the residents actually own the housing structure and they move in their homes into the land where the park is located and pay rent to place their home onto the plot of land. So in those communities, you'll find homeowners. I mean, there's at times can be substantial pride of ownership because there's a shared alignment between the homeowners and the community owners. They're a stakeholder, they have skin in the game. And oftentimes you'll see nicer parks just aesthetically where the tenants own a majority of the homes. And then the last is the regional differences. Any part throughout the country, you'll see different types of parks simply because of the geographic location. So along the West Coast, Arizona, Florida, Northeast, I talked a little bit about the retirement areas of the country and resort style communities. That's a different type. You just, because of the weather or the lifestyle, the recreational slant of those regions of the country, you see different types of parks. You know, the type variation really manifests in just the visual appeal, not necessarily the structures, but they're typically located in near mountains, near rivers, lakes, and oceans. And it's catering towards either the recreational crowd or retirees. In the Deep South, you get a different type of park. Again, these are broad generalizations and there are always exceptions to the comments that I'm making here, but in Deep South, they're a little bit more rundown. So those are, we do see communities in the Deep South where there's a significant portion of park-owned homes. And as a result, the homes aren't well-maintained and there isn't the pride of ownership there that we see in communities with tenant-owned homes. And then lastly, throughout the Great Plains, that is sort of the opposite of what we see in the Deep South. Those are generally well-maintained communities. People, there isn't the negative stigma associated with manufactured housing the further north that you get. And as a result, it's just another housing option. So single family, apartments, manufactured housing, they're all sort of viewed equally. And as a result, they're well maintained. You see pride of ownership and the operations generally run pretty smoothly. So that was my best attempt to give a lay of the land and an overview of the different types of communities. You know, property specific, you always get your own nuances in metro areas and specific properties. But in speaking in broad categories, these are the ways in which we see variations in types of manufactured housing communities. So how to find them? So we've been talking a little bit about, you know, there's all sorts of different classes. There isn't a standard way to classify them. We don't benefit from the price transparency and the robustness of price discovery as we do in multifamily and other commercial and office and retail. There are also few of them. So there are far fewer manufactured housing communities than all of those alternative property types that I just mentioned. And as a result, you really need to cast a wide net to find opportunities. So we don't have, well, there are, the major national brokers are involved in the industry. It's just not as robust a network. There aren't as many players. It's not as well-oiled a machine as you experience in some of the other areas. So just finding good deals is difficult. And as a result, you need to go through a variety of different channels. So just telling a little bit about my own journey. So I mentioned I got started in investments in manufactured housing communities in 2017, but I didn't actually start owning and operating parks until 2018. That's because I took a full year to establish a database and establish a system of marketing and reaching out and cultivating deal flow to really increase the robustness of the pipeline and be exposed to a sufficient number of deals such that I could pick through the rocks and find things that looked good. So, you know, that's looking at Mobile Home Park Store, which is probably the big dog in terms of the digital platforms that where transactions are facilitated, eBay, Craigslist, other, you know, random regional digital sites where people post listings. You can find a couple of them on LoopNet. You know, you just sort of haphazardly run into them scattered amongst the other major commercial real estate types. As I mentioned, there are brokers out there that focus specifically on manufactured housing. There are some good ones and there are some not so good ones. All the national brokerage firms, for the most part, have specialists who deal primarily in some of the institutional quality manufactured housing communities. And then even residential brokers, sometimes, you know, they find deals come through their pipeline and you'll find listings through residential brokers. We do a lot of work with wholesalers and working our own network of friends, community owners, and the tradespeople that we deal with through operating our parks. So this has been a fairly robust channel for us, and also just indicative of how, you know, I don't know, backwards or immature the industry is compared to some of the other alternatives. We find that just getting to know other operators, getting to know the mobile home dealers, the transporters and suppliers, those folks who are in the industry, are a very fertile ground for deal flow because they are interacting with people that want to sell their communities usually on a daily basis. So we spend a lot of time building relationships and getting to know others who own or work in the industry. And the primary way of reaching out to them, if it's not in person, is we send out a bunch of direct mailers and we cold call. So, you know, we've got these dozen or so channels that we go through all in an effort to find deals. So we do find a lot of deals. We don't put many offers in on deals and we close on far fewer deals. So I say all of this to say it's really hard and it takes a lot of work to cultivate deal flow. And that's one of the reasons why, again, this is so attractive is few people are willing to do the work. This isn't a type of product or asset class where you can go to a LoopNet and find all of the listings that are available, not a centralized digital way to quickly and easily get a sense for what the listings are. It takes a lot of work. So that means you have limited competition because people generally don't like to expend energy and do work. But if you are willing to do the work, there's an opportunity to find value and to make outsized returns. So once you've found a community that you think is worthwhile, how do you evaluate them? So diligence is critical in any of the commercial real estate investment options, but especially so in mobile home parks, primarily because of the state of the operations and the nature of the way the industry has grown up. So as I mentioned, there's a very small sliver of the industry that is institutionalized and run as a professional operation, like you would be accustomed to seeing in an apartment complex or an office building. Most of the manufactured housing community industry is mom and pop owners, and they use their mom and pop methods for running the operations. And what that means is, you know, they're generally set in their ways. They aren't accountable to outside shareholders or outside operators. And so, and many times they've built the place and they know it like the back of their hand. So that may have worked for them, but for an outside buyer and someone looking and trying to execute an evaluation of a prospective investment option, they don't have a lot of information to go on and may be sort of horrified by how little or how unprofessional the state of operations are. That's the nature of the industry. So I had a rude awakening in, you know, as I started my journey in 2017, coming from multifamily, because many multifamily assets that I was looking at were professionally run. And, you know, there's a third-party property management network that exists within multifamily that's fairly robust. The talent of the people, the caliber of the people is fairly high, and you can rely on decent financials, rent rolls, you know, just sort of common practices that are common throughout the industry. That didn't exist on either of the two parks that I first acquired, and it was a steep learning curve. I found myself saying no to a lot of what, you know, now I know as compelling opportunities, but because I didn't know what good looked like or what standard looked like, I just assumed that, you know, without a standard set of financials or a clean rent roll, that it was not worthwhile and represented something bad. I think, you know, my word of caution for people that are endeavoring to participate in this industry and make investments is you got to get comfortable with some level of unsophistication and some level of messiness in diligence, whether that's financial infrastructure or market, because it just isn't quite as buttoned up as you'd expect or may have heard in other areas. So we conduct our diligence, and it can generally be broken up into three different categories when you're evaluating a prospective deal: financial due diligence, infrastructure, and market. So for financial, we're looking for the standard rent roll, tax returns, and financials. As I mentioned, prepare yourself to be dissatisfied and surprised by the nature of the way financial records are kept in manufactured housing communities. We, as I mentioned, our first two parks were from mom and pop, first three parks were from mom and pop operators. They all had handwritten rent rolls. So this was truly a log of collections where, you know, in their handwriting, they would keep a record over years of who had paid the rent, who was living there, what the rent was, and any, you know, outstanding balance. In many cases, they didn't have a formal P&L. It simply was just a rent roll. So we have, in two of the three cases, not been able to obtain clean financials. So we were strictly making an investment decision based on a pro forma and what we see in the industry as a rule of thumb. And then tax returns, we found that mom and pop owners are reluctant to provide their tax returns. They don't really see the sense in providing it. And so, you know, that my word of caution on that is it's a little bit of the Wild West when it comes to maintaining financial records for mobile home parks. And so you have to kind of make do with whatever's provided. And if nothing's provided, that isn't a total red flag. It just means a little bit more digging and a little bit more comparable research that is required there. For infrastructure, so in this, you know, you're the dirt owner in an ideal case. You just own the land and the utilities. So utilities, you're going to inspect the roads for condition. You're going to look at the nature of the sewer system, the water system, and electrical system. You have a couple of different varieties on sewer. You can have city sewer, which is run by the municipality. It's really not yours to worry about. and typically can be relied upon for a solid means of operation. That's ideal case. It's the most hands-off, it's the cheapest to run, and it's the most attractive and liquid in an asset. The second sort of next best option is septic. So septic tanks have been in play for decades, and number of high volume throughout the country. It's widely used and is an operating working way in which you can run a sewage system. Things to watch out for there is the leach field. So, you know, typically septic systems involve a tank where sewage is stored, and then slowly over time, bacteria breaks down the sewage and then is excreted into what's called a leach field or a drainage field. Depending upon the soil composition, that over time, the soil can become saturated and the sewage system will fail because the leach field can no longer drain, and you know, you then have a flooding situation. So those are some things to watch out for and can be problematic for septic systems. There's also wastewater treatment plants. That really is a small scale of a city system. So cities, large municipalities, run wastewater treatment plants. They're typically very large operations, substantial infrastructure, and can be quite costly to operate. They do work, and like any mechanical thing, are subject to failure, but typically have very long lives. The cautionary tale on wastewater treatment plants is you don't want to own the park when it's near the end of its useful life, because they are quite expensive to repair and or replace. So typically that's a red flag for us. It's a deal breaker on small parks, because to replace a wastewater treatment plant could totally jeopardize the economics of the investment. And then the last one that we've seen that is a deal breaker for us is a lagoon. And that is the least sophisticated of sewage systems. It's simply a cesspool where sewage is drained into a pool to break down naturally over time. There's all sorts of reasons why that's unpleasant, aesthetics and smell being the two most obvious, but there are wild risks environmentally with that method. And in fact, some states have been going quite aggressively, if not outright banned lagoons. For water systems, again, you've got the city option, which is the most desirable. It's the cheapest to run and safest. This can be a very high risk situation. If you've seen the movie Aaron Brockovich, you can understand why. You're liable as a water provider for people's health, and it can be difficult and costly to maintain a high standard of quality for water. So city system preferable there. There are water wells also used widely throughout the country. Depending upon the quality of the water table and access to water, it can drive cost and difficulty in obtaining water. In one of our case studies, I'll talk a little bit about our experience with water wells. We took over a park that had a contaminated water well. So we have some experience there with wells. That's really the only other alternative to the city. For those, you just have to be careful and get them tested. So get a well operator's opinion. Demand to see the test results. Typically those are required by the state at least annually. So definitely something to look through. And then the electrical system, right, depending upon how the construct, the park is set up, that you can either own portion of the electrical lines or that be maintained directly by the city. Clearly having an option where the city owns the electrical is the most preferred. Because again, much like water, there can be some risk associated with owning and maintaining the electrical lines. Park-owned homes, again, to the extent that you're taking on a property that owns a portion of the housing stock, that is definitely something to check out as part of diligence. You know, you're going to be taking on a structure and hopefully filling it with residents or keeping residents there. So just as you would look for working mechanicals, plumbing, electrical, walls, flooring, smells, and roof leaks in single family and apartment communities, you'd also look for the same in the park-owned homes. So to the extent that they're in states of disrepair, need work, need to be bulldozed and hauled out of the park, that would drive, you know, concerns for you and costs during operation. And then permits and zoning being the last sub area within infrastructure that needs to be checked out. So typically cities, municipalities issue permits to mobile home park operators so that they are given the ability to operate parks. Also alongside that, that, you know, ensuring that the land is in fact zoned to be used as a mobile home park. So we've run across instances where the zoning did not support the density or the number of homes or placed restrictions on new homes that could be moved in. And that could put a damper on your plans if you plan to expand the livable area within the park. So permits and zoning being a critical component just to ensure that you can run the park the way that you want to achieve your business plan. And then lastly, market due diligence. So this is very similar to the market due diligence, really not a lot of nuance embedded within this zone of due diligence in contrast to the other two areas. The other two areas having a lot of nuance in manufactured housing relative to some of the other asset classes within commercial real estate. So market due diligence, you're looking to see, you know, what are the lot rents relative to three bedroom apartment rents? So what can you charge? What is your current lot rent in the park that you're looking to acquire? What do you think you can charge? Rule of thumb is that three bedroom apartment rents are typically twice as much as lot rent. Again, put yourself in the shoes of a prospective resident in your community. You have choices in terms of where you are going to decide to live. And this is the affordable housing business. So you've always got to evaluate, you know, would I make this choice given the price of this housing product, and ensuring that, you know, you aren't outpricing yourself or that the rents aren't way above a better housing option like single family home. Population, you know, we get really concerned about very rural areas. You want to ensure that you've got substantial population, typically more than 50,000 people within the metro area or above. We like to piggyback on leading demographers in U.S. enterprise. So Starbucks, Target, Walmart, Lowe's, Home Depot, the big retailers, they spend millions of dollars investing in predicting trends as it relates to population. So we like to see Walmarts within our areas, our markets where we choose to invest. You want to see economic activity, so robust job options. So jobs that are sourced from a variety of different industries, such that if one industry experiences a downturn in their particular sector, that there are other more durable, more steady employment options available in the community. Things that rhyme with healthcare, education, government jobs. Those are some of the things that we like to see, in addition to, you know, the more robust high growth areas as well. Last thing that may slightly be new for or a nuance for manufactured housing is running test debt. So how do you gauge the demand? You know, you can look at pricing, you can see vacancy relative to other parks in the neighborhood or the city and relative to other Class C, Class D apartments, which are typically the comparable option for manufactured housing, the alternative option. We like to run test ads. So we actually place test ads in Craigslist, in the main newspaper, in some of the more high traffic retail areas. We put up bandit signs where we can to actually get a sense for the demand for housing within our park. So we spin up a fake phone number using Grasshopper and set up a test email address. And we actually run test ads for a 2 to 4 week period of time and see how many inquiries we get. We like to see about 10 to 20 per week, 10 to 20 inquiries. We think that that will drive sufficient demand such that if we do have a vacancy that we need to, vacancies within the park that we need to fill, that volume, 10 to 20 a week, is sufficient enough to drive infill activity. So I'm running out of time here, cognizant that we've only got 10 minutes left. So I want to make sure that we cover the case studies. So apologies if I blaze through the rest here. But that those are the core components of, you know, how do we evaluate parks? So what does good look like? It's parks that have financials, at least the rents through estoppel agreements, if you have to, that check out, that the infrastructure is sound and you've gone through inspections with professional operators of those utilities, and really gotten a sense for the condition of the utilities and the cost that it will take to operate those utilities in good working order, and then evaluating the market and ensuring that there's sufficient demand for your housing product in the area. I'll quickly go over this. We've talked about the hardships of operating mobile home parks. This is an industry that is several decades behind the times in terms of operational maturity relative to its closest sister, which is apartments. So one of the ways in which we do not benefit is through a robust third-party property management network. So this is just an industry that third-party does exist, but it's almost exclusively available for the Sam Zells of the world. So the 4 and 5-star parks, the retirement age-restricted communities that are in the premier markets like Florida, California, Arizona, and the Pacific Northwest. Everything else, you've got to rely on hands-on management. So it's you as an operator or someone that you're hiring on site to be day-to-day eyes and ears. So I think I've come across this myth in getting to know about the industry. And one thing that I try to share with others that are looking and getting interested in manufactured housing is it can be tempting to see this as a passive investment because of the fact that you just may own the dirt in certain cases. Don't be fooled into thinking about that and really think critically about how passive an investment in a mobile home park would be, because you don't have the luxury of relying on a very capable, mature operator that is a third-party property manager. So I listed out some of the things here that are involved in operating a mobile home park. There's a lot to it. And while you do have the option of hiring an on-site manager, in many cases, they can only handle a couple of the bullet points on this list, in which case you as the owner operator are on the hook to do. So for us, you know, I'd say we rely on we have on-site managers for all three of our communities, and none of them can handle all of these. And at most, our most capable manager can handle probably 2/3 of these. So we find ourselves spending a lot of time managing the minutia of mobile home parks. And we continue to expect to do that until, you know, the third-party property management industry starts to serve this need and ramps up and makes services available to community operators. I think I saw a question come through here. Got a couple of questions. Why don't I get through and I'll just share one case study and then I can handle the three questions there. Thanks guys for raising them. So I'll go quickly. I'll do 3-minute drill here on Grays Creek Mobile Home Community. I do, for those that are interested in learning more about these case studies that we've got here, I have showcased this, both of these on podcasts, and I'd be happy to share links to those stories for folks that are interested in learning more and hearing all the gory details about how we found and did due diligence and finally acquired them. So this was our first park that we discovered in summer of 2018, actually a year ago. It was brought to our attention. So we found it through, I was talking about our network of friends and owner operators. This is after a year of building a database and doing cold calling and direct mail, spending, you know, $35,000 and lots of hours of blood, sweat, and tears. Lo and behold, it didn't yield our first deal. We got it through our network of friends. So they were in the midst of a transition to setting up a fund to raise capital to acquire dozens of mobile home parks. They had had this park under contract that they sourced through direct mail, and they needed to get rid of their pipeline of opportunities simply so they could focus and get their fund ramped up. So we saw the details. They had assembled quite a robust due diligence package. We really liked what we saw, and we took that contract assignment from them, and we gladly paid them a fee for it. We faced, you know, that was sort of the start of a long journey. So we spent most of the summer from July to November of 2018 performing due diligence and negotiating with the owner. So this was an owner that was very absentee, runs a large business in the region, and operating, owning mobile home parks was, you know, priority number 57 for him. So really had no interest in owning it. And as a result, it was very difficult to get the information that we needed from him and to negotiate on things that, on problems that we found during diligence. So one of the major problems was we found a contaminated water well. So this well, the park was served through a water well, and based on the region of the country where it's located in Fayetteville, North Carolina, that is a region where the water table is just naturally contaminated with radium. And this park had been operating at an unsafe level for a sustained period of time, and the state had identified it as a problem and demanded that the owner fix it. Well, we didn't know anything about operating wells and really had no interest in taking on that type of risk because, you know, headline news, contaminated water well is quite scary, and you could subject yourself to significant risk by poisoning people with bad well water. So, but we spent the time and energy to get to know what our risks were, to size them, to quantify what it could mean downside wise if things were to go wrong, or what it would take to repair it. And that took a lot of speaking to experts, learning, and really assessing gray areas. So we ultimately got comfortable. We were able to negotiate a price discount amongst a number of other different risk mitigators, ultimately closed the deal. The opportunity and why this was worth all the work was huge upside on rent increases. We think the rents are about $50 to $75 below market in a growing market. There were 25 vacant lots, so it's a 75 space park. About 50 of the lots were occupied. We ran our test ads and the phone rang off the hook. So we thought that there was sufficient demand there to fill up those vacant lots pretty quickly. We saw that the park was just totally mismanaged and forgotten about. And as a result, the operating expenses were way high. We thought there was huge opportunity there to bring those down to a reasonable level and juice our NOI. And it was located in an area in Fayetteville that is surrounded by new single family housing development. So while we like to own things forever, we thought that, hey, if we could reposition this asset and juice the rents, operate it professionally, and fill in all the vacancies, we could probably then also realize the upside of selling it to a developer who would pay us for the land in a way that was priced according to single family homes and not manufactured housing. So those were the things that were appealing to us. Again, go to all the gory details with Dan Hanford a couple of months ago on his podcast. Happy to refer folks to that episode for all the details of Gray's Creek. We're about a half year into owning and operating that park. We've got eight of the 25 filled, and we are well on our way to resolving the contaminated water well. We are hooking up to the city line, and we just got the easement from our neighbor on that last week. So we're thrilled. I'll skip over our last case study there. Want to provide people with an opportunity to learn a little bit more about what we do at Upward Communities. Our website at upwardcommunities.com. We actually do have all our communities and a blurb on what those communities are like, where they're located. We have links to those websites. If you're curious, you can see Gray's Creek. It is linked there. We love talking to other people who are in the industry or looking to get into the industry. And I benefited from other operators that were just looking to share information and help others learn. I like to do the same. It's fun, and I like helping others, you know, find something that's interesting and potentially financially beneficial. So please don't hesitate to reach out. You can reach me at john@upwardcommunities.com. You can find us on the website at upwardcommunities.com, and I'm happy to help out in any way I can. So I'll do my best here on the I will do my best here on the question. So we've got Richard Hall. I'll just go in from the top of the stack. Richard says, while MHPs are cheaper and sell for higher cap rates than multifamily properties, if you are a true value investor, then your value add or creation efforts produce a lower equity multiple. That is true. So let's assume that the cap rates remain constant. I exercise or operate as a value investor in the mobile home park space because I see through operational levers that I can pull an opportunity to create value. So we buy assets at price X. We pull levers so that we can augment the value, whether that's increasing rents, filling vacant spaces, making assets more liquid, i.e., you know, taking away private utilities and creating public utilities, so expanding the pool of potential buyers. Those are ways that we are able to increase value and unlock value and operate as a value investor in that way. So hear your point, Richard, spot on for sure. But you know, through operational measures, we think we're still able to retain our value investor card by pulling those operational levers. Paul Martin has a question. You mentioned that you have partners across the country. Can you discuss working with a distributed team? Are you all part of the same company or different companies in partnership? I'll tackle that one. So great question, Paul. So this is one of the ways I talked a little bit about at start. You know, I didn't really think working at Accenture, global management consulting firm, how that would help me at all in running mobile home parks. One of the ways that I just got accustomed to working with distributed teams just by necessity at Accenture, because our teams were globally distributed. So getting accustomed to working virtually with teams was a key muscle that I developed so that I could be successful in my current operation and working with folks that are located in Chicago, Cleveland, and upstate New York. So yes, we do most of our work virtually. So we have virtual calls Monday, Wednesday, and Fridays. We use, you know, collaboration tools like all the Google Suite, G Drive, right? We use Trello and Asana to project manage our activities. So the cool thing about technology is it makes this stuff a lot easier and makes virtual work something that can be done actually quite efficiently. We do meet up quarterly usually at our properties. So we do property tours and go on-site trips. We just got back from a trip to the Carolinas where we met up and did some community building events. But that's typically how we're able to operate. And I think we're at time. So thanks, Brandon, for letting me go over 2 minutes here. And appreciate everyone giving me the time to share about this interesting niche. And like I said, please don't hesitate to reach out to me to learn more, or if you have additional questions that I can cover offline.
All right, John, thank you so much for that presentation. It's you know, always good to hear a different you know, asset class or way to invest money, you know, self-storage, mobile home, multifamily. So there's more than one way to skin the cat, in other words.
For sure.
So I appreciate your time today. We're running a little bit short on time, so I'm sorry to be a little bit abrupt, but we've got to push everybody into room one. So thank you for your time. Enjoy the nice, warm Manhattan weather. And we'll catch you at the next conference, sir.
Sounds good. Thanks, Brandon.
All right. Have a great one.
You too.
All right, everyone. Like I said, please go ahead and there's the troublemaker. Head over to room one where Dan's supposed to be right now. We'll be closing out the day.
It's backwards.
Register for the next event is what that says. You've heard it all day. NextMFIN.com. Go to the podcast, post a review, send a screenshot to Stacy@MultifamilyInvestorNation.com. Enter to win the iPad. Also, make sure you go to the fundraiser for Whitney Sewell. I'm going to post that again here. Make sure you go there, do your job, and fund that fundraiser. We'll see you. That is it. Thanks for tuning in today. And hope you have a great rest of the day. Go to room one. Here are the golden nuggets of the wrap-up for the day. Thank you for joining.